welcome to the Face of Pro-Life. Today I'm speaking with Friar Roderic Burke from the Franciscan Friars of the Immaculate. Thank you so much for joining us today, Friar Roderic.
It's good to be here, Corinn.
Now, you wanted to talk a little bit about viability.
Right.
And with its importance with the Supreme Court decisions that legalized abortion,
right.
One of the concepts was that it was perfectly reasonable to abort a child that wouldn't be otherwise viable,
right.
Meaning it couldn't live outside the womb. We'll talk about the silliness of that to begin with, because no child could really live outside
right.
the womb,
right.
No matter how old. But before the show, we were talking a little bit about an interesting aspect about viability that has come upon you now. How did you start thinking about this? What brought you to think about this?
Well, I always thought that the whole idea was silly, as you mentioned, that the is it really inviable? You know, in other words, is that really why people are having abortions? No, you know, the inviability is, that the baby's very viable right where it is.
Right.
And that's why people who don't want to be viable want to remove it from where it is, so it's not
so
viable.
So it's not viable.
If we're not viable, the problem will take care of itself. And, of course, that's not what the problem is. They have unwanted pregnancy because of the advent of contraception and the whole sexual malaise that has come, or the moral malaise that has come because of that. So the abortion then takes over, and this really ridiculous excuse comes in to justify it, the viability.
And a lot of people, even people who are, you know, themselves pro-life, a lot of people will agree with the Roe versus Wade decision, because they think that Roe versus Wade legalized abortion up to 12 weeks. The first trimester. What they don't know is that on the same day, Doe versus Bolton was decided, and that legalized abortion throughout 9 months.
Right.
And so at first they thought, well, you know, the first 3 months, you know, the baby's not viable, like we say. So what is your argument against that?
Well, I can argue on that directly, but we're just taking on the idea of viability and make it more and point out how ridiculous it really is. And that is, looking at the womb, people can sort of see that that the baby can only survive in this womb, then yeah, maybe it's not as viable and therefore not as alive as a later term might be. And so look at that, made a series of slides, and the first slide is the baby in the womb. So the baby in the womb is in this one small place, and that's very small place compared to even a human being. So it's it's a very small little baby in the womb of the mother.
A very specialized compartment.
Very specialized,
that's
right.
Nurturing the baby. It's safe for the baby so that the baby can
right.
develop.
And we think that this is a really good reason to keep the baby here. Not somewhere else, because it can live here, and it's a real human being.
And they're less hassle here. They don't cry, they don't poop, they do nothing.
Right.
They're there.
At this point, of course, they're worried about what comes later, but that's the part of life, too. Life is messy, so. But the at a later point, I also have this idea that if you, sort of take that picture and move outward to a larger world, you can see that a lot more people survive in that larger world, and that sure enough indicates this idea that people who are older are more viable, quote unquote, and that they are more survivable and can survive in a wider range of things, and that sort of lends credence to this whole idea.
Mm-hmm.
So if you zoom out from to a larger picture, you see a crowd. And then, if you larger world and more independent living, and then if you go out further, you can see that that's even a bigger world than that. You know, in other words, you can really see how on this small womb is this tiny, tiny little place, and that would indicate you know, a very small place, and you can see how small a crowded area would look in this aerial view of a city. This is Manhattan, actually. So, and then if you go even larger to say the tri-state area, even New York City looks small compared to that. So you can really see that this is makes the room look much, much smaller. And you can sort of say, well, if you keep going out, you know, really has proved the point that the viability, you know, it is kind of true that this seemingly true that the viability is seems credible. But if you go out even further, you start to see that the most of the Earth really can't support human life, even adult life.
Right. Right.
That this idea of viability only goes so far. So if you're in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, you're not going to last too long. If you're out in the Sahara Desert, you're not going to last too long. If you if you suddenly are here, here we are in the studio here, if we're suddenly transported to this area, to only any one of these areas that cover, say, 80% of the land mass, land surface, or surface area of the Earth, that really we're not as viable as we think we are.
So it's a matter of location.
Yeah.
So you're viable here, but you're not viable in Antarctica.
Right. And this is a very good reason to not be transport anyone to those places. Say if you could do that, you know, the Star Trek transporter beam, if you just say.
Oh, there's a lot of people I'd like to transport today.
Yeah, sometimes you get frustrated people. And so, but, you know, we all know how much, you know, how precious life is, and this whole thing should show us how precious life is, and for the poor as well as the rich, you know, and that's the idea that the if you're out in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean and you can't survive sort of harkens to this the idea of the Titanic, where the Titanic was you know, this ship that was built really out of hubris almost. It had this idea that even God can't sink the Titanic, right? You know. And of course,
he does not like to be taunted.
And these people that are on board are really enjoying life. They're basically sort of, you know, conquerors of the world. And you know, the whole idea of that movie, the Titanic, came out very well with that. Even almost too much. You know, they almost glamorized the poor to an extreme. But the there they were really thinking they're on top of the world, and they're thinking probably sort of look on the rest of the world as being and the poor people as being beneath them, and perhaps not as viable as them. You know, and then, but sure enough, in the maiden voyage, you know, things didn't work out too well. But even just, you know, talking about the people on board beforehand, they were, that the movie that's, you know, had a whole romance scene that yeah, the girl was, you know, and the guy were up in the front, and I forgot the names.
I never saw the movie, so.
I once seen that this is the last movie I saw before entering the community, by the way. So it's, you know, it's had some few bad scenes too. So I family warnings, but they're standing on the front rail of the ship, and he told her to close her eyes. She slipped on the front rail of the ship, the wind blowing in her face. You know, the ship going 24 miles per hour or so.
Yeah. And it's a very famous scene.
Yeah. Yeah.
I haven't seen that scene.
And the sun's setting the whole nine yards.
How glorious,
And she said, now open your eyes, and this whole glorious scene's in front of her. You know, and there they are, the youth of their life, and really enjoying life, and you know, and at that point, you know, there they are, you know, almost victorious in life, and at the grand
very
moment.
Very viable.
Very viable, right. But if he had also, like let go by chance or by purpose, you know, and then suddenly she's not viable. You know, she's over the front, lands in the cold water, and the ship's course right on top of her. But the, you know, and I think if you're, you know, I'm not a movie maker, but if I can tell that if that happened, that would kind of ruin.
Put damper on the movie to begin with.
Wouldn't exactly.
You already know it's not going to have a good ending.
That's not the anticlimactic as far as whole romance, and of course tragic as far as the loss of life. So this has you know, ramifications to the whole idea of viability, is that because you're viable, it's not a reason to move someone else who's not as viable to another place, or if someone is viable in the womb, why move them to another place? And as you can see, when the Titanic sank, suddenly these people who are so, you know, on top of the world on this incredible ship that could never sink, all of a sudden, many were in the water dying, being very unviable, and the rest were in lifeboats that were very much less viable than the big ship was. The idea that we're so viable, and the and babies are not viable, and often, of course, the poor are targeted for abortion, mm-hmm. and contraception, because as Margaret Sanger started off with, a very arrogant, very eugenics mentality that. The powerful and the rich, strong should survive, very much like Adolf Hitler.
Right, like an evolutionary type of idea. Survival of the fittest, and that the poor were weeds and needed to
not
be
as viable. Right.
And it's a really interesting concept that you bring up, because as I'm watching these slides, like you said, the baby is viable in the womb, and all that baby relies on needs. The only thing that baby requires is the mother.
Right.
Whereas the mother, placed in a larger crowd and in life, requires many more people to keep her viable.
Right.
You know?
Human being is viable on his own.
Right. And so it's not just one person that she requires. Right. She needs a whole community. And as you go out in the city, the whole city requires more and more people to, keep their life going the way it is. I mean, from the time, from the electricity that comes into your house to the water, all these things that we require for life require other people.
Right.
And that one baby just requires one person.
Right. This rugged individualism is not as cracked up as we think it is.
Yeah.
And we're a lot smaller than we think it is. Pan out, not only does the mother become smaller, but so does everyone else.
Right.
It goes a little, here's another picture of a place where you can't live, and that's, this is the North Pole, and this is actually summertime. You can see, because there's not as much ice, and it's not lit up. It's complete darkness in the wintertime. So even in the wintertime, though, you can't survive there. And anywhere in North America or in Northern Europe, you can't survive in the wintertime. Outside, and then the same thing with the South Pole. Very much the same thing. And then, if you go out even further, it just shows that the Earth is really a very small place too. Just as its mother is very small, so is Mother Earth. We need a place to live as much as a baby does. And this idea that, the Earth is very small compared to the rest of the Earth.
Small. Well, the Earth just as small, really. When you put it in perspective with the universe, that's so little space, really. That.
And here's a picture of the Earth and the Moon. Actually, you see the faint Moon over there. That's taken from the Voyager about. 6 million miles out from the Earth, and it already looks very small, a lot of black space. So if you're suddenly transported from where you are right now to just any random spot within that picture, you have very small chance of survival.
Yeah.
I mean, if you all of a sudden blink, you're out in the middle of space. If Scotty makes a mistake on the transporter and beams Captain Kirk out to any place besides that one
spot,
and the one spot on the surface of the Earth that's just right, so you won't drop from the middle of the sky and land, or get drowned in the water because you get transported 20 feet deep into the ocean or something. Only that surface, and only certain spots on that surface will you actually survive. And then if even goes more than that, here's a picture of from the same spacecraft, Voyager, but this is taken out about 4 billion miles out. This is the last picture of the Earth. If you can't see it, it's right in that streak of light to the right. There's a sort of pink streak there. That's a lens flare, because the sun's actually very close to the shot, because the Earth's rather close to the sun. So this Voyager's outside of the solar system at this point, and that little dot toward the lower side of that lower end of that ray. And it's kind of neat, because that ray almost looks like puts some brightest ray there on the screen. There's almost puts a spotlight on Earth.
On
you know,
Earth.
You know, the one little Earth. But this is made famous by Carl Sagan. You see a little pale blue dot there. I hope it's visible on the TV. But he talks about how that one blue dot is where all of our history is taking place, all of our cares and concerns throughout the history of mankind, all of our empire building, all this. And he was an atheist. It's kind of amazing to see that he's an atheist when he sees how small we are compared to the
and
world.
And insignificant, yeah.
And here's the same picture with a little bit of an indicator there to make sure you can see it. But it's really a pinpoint. I say it was only 1/8 of a pixel wide on the on the Voyager. So that this image here is really it's not blown up, but this is enhanced so that the one pixel that was actually brighter was reduced to what it would be on there. So it's kind of like a lot of detail enhancement to get the blue dot to be how it would actually look for the Voyager. And so that one place is where is Mother Earth, and that little Mother Earth, of course, can look a lot tinier than that if you go out and take a picture from the nearest star, for instance. You know, it would just our Mother Earth would be much smaller than the mother carrying that baby would look
from Manhattan,
aerial shot of Manhattan, right? So we're not as viable as you think we are. We're not as godlike as we think we are. We can't build unsinkable ships. We can't, we really shouldn't, of course, be gods and kill babies.
Kill
innocent babies.
God's or anybody.
Children. Right, right.
But especially
any
babies.
Life, right? So that's really what that was my idea. To show how tiny we are and how unviable we are in a sense, but it also shows how it kind of gives us a God's eye view. In other words, Carl Sagan, the atheist, made that picture famous, but it really should have given a clue that God, you know, that from God's point of view, we are very, very small. We're also very, very special.
Right, right.
And that one little blue dot is very special. It's very special to us, of course, as even Carl Sagan points out, that this is where everything happens. That, our viable area is very small, and really we make it a very big hell for ourselves if we get in this mentality that it's we're not going to be welcoming, and that the human life is not worthy or can only be valued based on strength and viability and things like that. And it harkens back, of course, to the whole thing with the Roe v. Wade, how viable are we, and how silly the whole question is. We're all very unviable, even if we're in the best of places and we have the best of care, we're going to live a certain amount of time.
Right.
You know, we're all headed for the grave, you know, and all those graves are all filled with the patients of, this big, vast metropolitan graveyard you see in New York City or whatever, are all filled with the patients of very good doctors.
Yeah.
You know, because the doctors do what they can, and then at a certain point they can't do anymore, and so we're not as viable as we think we are, and we shouldn't be, looking at people in that way. It's a kind of quantitative way of looking at the value of people, whereas really the people, each person is very unique, and we have to treat them as such, and love them, and see the value in the individual, not what they can do for us or for me or for anybody else. Yeah.
You bring up a lot of really, I mean, it's a beautiful concept, because you say really viability is all a matter of your perspective and your location, And the one thing that you mentioned is that, you know, God loves us so much, even though to him we're so, so insignificant.
Right.
You know, but he sent his only son. You know, that's how important we are. That's and, right. You know, for us to turn our backs on him and, you know, try to be like gods in all the stupid things that we do, from in vitro fertilization to contraception and horribly to abortion, you know, to take the gift of life that he has given to us and snuff it out because of whatever inconvenience or whatever. And when you kind of put it in perspective, no matter what mess you've gotten yourself into, it's so insignificant
right.
compared to
right.
all the other messes in the world
right.
that with the people around you, you can work it out.
Right. Working out people around us, that's so important for having a decent life, right? I mean, really, the abortion is all about, you know, having enough resources for everybody, everybody and having this great life. Well, you know, we have more resources in America anyways. You have more resources
right.
than we ever had, you know, and historically speaking, we have more resources and more things and more pleasures and more different kinds of food to eat, more different kinds of warm houses and places to drive and fly and see and do and things that kings could never dream of doing
right.
back 200 years ago. So it's amazing what we have, and yet it hasn't made us happy.
Right.
Does that make us happy? No. If it doesn't make us happy, why are we trying so hard to do all that, including going as far as bringing about contraception and abortion, when none of that's that maximizing of resources for each individual is really going to make us happy.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas knowing the value of people and knowing the value of mothers and knowing the value of
fathers
of
too.
Fathers, right? That's right. and then the values of your neighbor, society, and
children,
and children, and the whole gambit, the whole cooperative mentality, the whole getting along, the whole care of everybody. You know, that's what makes
life worth living.
Worth living. A friar of ours went to India, and it was very, very tough there for an American. You know, very hot, and very. No air conditioning, the water's
the water's not drinkable.
Right, and you have to really boil it or something, and the food's not so plentiful, and such like that. But the people were great.
Yeah.
People were wonderful, and that's what made the place a heaven on earth. And he really loved it there, you know. I'm not sure if his health would enable him to stay there or not. But anyway, he was. It's now in Benin, so that's it's a similar situation. But it's really the people and how well they get along that is really what makes a real heaven on earth.
And when we spend all of our lives, you know, trying to, you know, be part of groups and surround ourselves with friends and
that's right.
And yet the people that we'd be most closest to, our children, we're willing to sacrifice for different.
Different
reasons.
And hopefully it's not because people think it out very well. I think it's because they don't think it out very well. And this whole mentality that's out there has been built up by television and mass media and stuff that militates against clear thinking, I think. You know?
Yeah.
So it's, I think there is a lot of hope, and there's it's not too hard to show people that the larger picture and, you know, how precious our life is. You know, the films, things like this will show the importance of real ecology. The ecology is not based on wiping out, you know, the majority of the population, which some radical environmentalists advocate.
Right.
But rather one that, you know, actually takes care of the planet and of the ground that's needed for growing crops and in the air we need to breathe as is needed, you know. I mean, but also it's something that looks at the importance of the individual. even the small ones.
Yeah, the smallest of ones. Even though, like you put it in perspective, it's like we're all very, 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 very small. But
it takes a
lot of us to take care of Earth.
Right.
You know, the more people there are, actually, the more there are to take care of the Earth, not just to reap its resources, but to replenish them and nurture the Earth, because, you know, people do a lot, are needed a lot for doing, you know, taking care of various areas of the
Right. A lot of cures and a lot of the solutions to some of the lack of resources would be solved by perhaps the very people who have been aborted, as Mother Teresa pointed out. And so it's very, it also goes into the whole thing about the pleasure seeking, is that if we are being very selfish like that, then we are going to be consumers, and we are going to go out there and consume a lot of the resources and materials. So the whole contraceptive thing is linked to the whole hedonistic thing, which is very bad for the ecology. If everyone's out there thinking they're going to get happiness from pleasure, well, you got to consume a lot of resources to get any kind of pleasure out of this world. So you're going to, it is bad for the environment. The whole, it's really not the big, antagonism between population and pro-family motives and the environmentalist motives. Mm-hmm. Both the problems are be the pollution on one side, the environmentalists are worried about, and the hedonism and bad family morals on the the pro-family people are worried about. These are the things that it's not that. Really, that reconcilable. I think that's just what's needed is clear thinking, a wide view, a God's eye view, if you wish, not to be like God, but to see the whole picture, that broad-minded picture,
and cooperate with God's plan.
Cooperate with God's plan, right?
And that's the easiest thing to do.
Right.
When
in the long run,
to move against them, that's not a good idea.
Right. Even moving against them seems like the easiest thing to do. It's not very, very rapidly. We're starting to find that out.
Look at the Titanic.
Look at the Titanic economy in the United States being challenged by the very fact you have too few people coming into the workforce. Well, the Titanic economy of the Chinese or the Japanese. Those are all ready to sink because we're not having enough people coming in to fill the jobs and support the older
population.
Right.
Yeah, because when you used to have 5 or 6 kids, you'd have that many people to share the work. And well, thank you so much for this perspective. It's very interesting, and I hope our viewers can understand the beauty of this analogy. We hope that you learned something. Talk to your family and friends about the things that you've learned. Realize that your life, as well as every life that God has planted on this earth, is very, very precious. And when you look in the mirror the next time, you realize yours too is the face of pro-life. Join us again next time.